We're really live. Hi, everybody. Hey, we're live and welcome to the show. I am coming to you this week from the Villages in Florida, where every house comes with two golf carts and a Viagra fountain. Let's start the show.
In a cabin, going crazy, 'cause a flu that's worse than swine swept the planet, so damn it, here we are in quarantine.
Hello, and welcome to Virtual Comedy Show. Here are some etiquette guidelines for Virtual Comedy Show. Please arrive 15 minutes early. Please be quiet, except for laughing. We've been a Zoom meeting civilization for more than a year. Come on, you know the drill. Just be polite. We would like to see your face as part of the audience. Let's be social, not just distant. So get comfortable, plan to laugh, but not heckle, and let's make our semi-quarantined world a bit more normal for a little while. Thanks, and enjoy the Virtual Comedy Show.
Hey, everyone! It's time for the Virtual Comedy Show, starring Brad Tassel and Steve Goody. Tonight, Brad and Steve welcome their very special guest,
Phil Van Tee,
live from their respective vaccinated homes. And now, please welcome Brad Tassel.
Oh, the crowd goes wild. And Steve, I forgot that you are an administrator on my page, aren't you?
Yes, so.
That is fantastic. Thank
you. That'll explain your banking situation.
That's right. Steve did a great job, and he takes over $10,000 for that job every year that I know of. So, hi, and welcome to the show, everybody. I'm Brad Tassel, live from Doc Pierce's background. Doc Pierce is my parents' restaurant in Mishawaka. Actually, I'm in Florida at the Villages, which is retirement. I've done three nights of shows here, and the background here is very white. Is everybody else good? I'm seeing everybody in here. You look good. Are you feeling good, Mr. Goody and Alice and Elena and everybody and Valerie? I've had a great week here, which means I didn't have any time to write jokes, so be ready for this. Ha ha. All right. Are you ready? Are we ready to go?
Ready to go.
Because we have a great show. We have an encore show with Perry Barton and Phil Van Tee, which is a fantastic thing. So here we go. Let's start. Okay, did you see this? First, Mila Kunis and Ashton Kutcher, now Kristen Bell and Dax Shepard, have announced they do not bathe their kids until they're really dirty or they stink. Yeah. Look, when I was growing up, unless I stunk up the building or got the house dirty, I didn't even exist to my parents. How is this news right now? I mean, if it weren't for the $5,000 they spent on braces, they wouldn't even ask me to brush my teeth. I mean, how are parents doing this? And by the way, oh no, you don't make them take a bath until they need one. I was kicked out of the house at 8 a.m. and told not to come back inside till it was dark or I lost a limb. What is going on? My parents didn't care when or where I went as long as they didn't have to hear about it or I stayed outside the whole time. I mean, anybody else? This is like some huge news that they're not bathing their kids every second of the day. Oh, wait. I see some breaking news. Are you ready? Hillary Duff let her kids spend a day without hair gel. Oh, that's parenting news, everybody. All right. That could be a bit that, if I work it out, might be in the show. Next, hey, the royal family sent out well wishes to Meghan Markle on her 40th birthday. That the royal family sending out well wishes. The note read, "Dear Meghan, the Queen wishes you would fall in a well." Well wishes.
Brilliant.
That's going to be the height of this set.
Good one.
Yeah, it was a good one. That's going to be, let's hang our hat on that one, shall we? Hey, here's exciting. I read this today. Ex-Trump Secretary of State Mike Pompeo is being investigated for a missing $5,800 bottle of booze that was gifted to him by the Japanese. Did you see this? They gave him a $5,800 bottle of booze. No one knows where it is, and it's illegal to receive any gifts that aren't registered, right? And Pompeo said he doesn't recall receiving the expensive hooch at all, and maybe he'll remember better after he gets over this incredible hangover.
Here. Destroying the evidence.
That's right. Yeah, destroying it and then peeing it out. Okay. By the way, has anyone ever heard the old saying, don't go to bed angry or leave the house angry because you don't know if your spouse, parent, etc. might die and the last interaction you had with them, with your loved one, was anger or dysfunction? Has anybody ever heard that? Never go to bed angry because they might die and the last interaction you had was negative. And for the rest of your life, you have the knowledge that you didn't resolve things before the end. And I say that's stupid, is what I say. And I'll tell you why. Now, don't misunderstand me. I think you should not leave the house or go to bed angry, but not because somebody might die, but because we probably won't die. Okay? Do you understand what I'm saying right here? I would rather die than have to wake up in the morning and hear about all this crap again. If I leave the house angry and we've had a big argument, please hit me with a freaking bus so I don't have to walk back in there and deal with any of that junk. Do you understand what I'm saying, everybody?
Yeah, we do.
Okay, that's good. No punchlines, but that's my thoughts.
I thought the bus was the punchline.
The bus was the punchline. Hit me with a friggin' bus. Well, the I guess the concept is the punchline. The concept is I don't want to go to bed angry because I don't want to wake up and have to deal with it again. Okay. Hey, a federal judge in Colorado has sanctioned two lawyers who filed lawsuits challenging the 2020 elections, saying that they were frivolous and not warranted. The lawyers' lawsuits were so bad and filled with idiocy that they quoted Trump tweets, provided zero evidence, and they actually even used affidavits from people that they'd never met and didn't even know if they worked on the election. The judge ruled they had acted in bad faith. Now, in one statement, one of the lawyers took exception and said, "We weren't acting. Our faith was the baddest faith of all the faiths in history." And please, let's give $1.6 billion. Okay. That one I didn't know where to go with. Next. Oh, by the way, at this point, everyone is asking for the resignation of Governor Cuomo, except Governor Cuomo. So, he has defended numerous sexual harassment charges by women over many years by showing us images of him also sexually harassing men. I love that his excuse is, "See, I love rubbing everybody." Little tongue there. I don't know if he did the tongue thing, though. That's going on. I wish I had the volume up so I could hear the huge laughter. I like that Phil did a good thing. He turned his camera off and just a picture of him smiling like he likes it. Now, this is something that happened today. Mexico is suing U.S. gun makers for bringing $2.4 billion worth of guns into Mexico illegally. I know. So they want a huge cash settlement, or they want them to pay for a wall to keep more guns out. They'll build the wall. Okay. Hey, this one you have to remember two stories to know. First of all, Australian Olympic athletes have been condemned for their excessive drinking and behavior during their flight home after the games. Did y'all see that? Wow.
Yep.
Flight attendants were asked why they were struggling to take care of the rowdy Aussies. One replied, "Hey, this isn't Frontier and we ain't got no duct tape." So, if you've seen the story about the, did y'all see the story about the them Frontier duct taping the guy to the seat who'd been touching people. So the Aussies are a little bigger than that. All right. Only 17 more pages. By the way, it's fun down here in the villages, but it's like Hotel California. It's like they've created these little towns that look like Disney downtowns, and you get your golf cart, but the whole world doesn't exist outside of here, and it's really, it's a little weird is what it is. Speaking of that, a new biography, crap, my entire thing just closed. Hold on a second, kids. There, it's back.
Hit by a bus. I'm sorry.
I'd rather get hit by a bus than have to deal with my wife in the morning. That was the point. Okay. A new biography of Osama bin Laden says the terrorist leader thought that the attack of September 11th would cause the U.S. to remove all troops from Saudi Arabia and the entire Middle East. Because, you know, Pearl Harbor made sure we were hands off in Japan. Okay, I expected more out of that joke.
You know, so did we.
Yeah. Well, the rest of this is no joke. I just found it fascinating. This book on Osama bin Laden, other wacky insights. Did you know that bin Laden had tons of cases of Just for Men hair dye because he didn't like the gray, and he would wear a cowboy hat all around his compound because he knew that U.S. spies were watching. The most startling revelation for me, and possibly Steve and all the men here, was that bin Laden was only 54 when he was killed. 2 years younger than me. So who knew that 22 wives, 58 kids, and radical terrorism could make you look like Sauron from Lord of the Rings? I didn't know that. Oh, Gandalf. Okay, anyway. Okay, now the joke that my wife did not like at all. And I think maybe the last one. This is the last joke. So, Steve, I hope you're ready.
I'm ready.
Mattel is planning on creating 6 Barbie dolls based on women scientists. This is very cool. Some who worked on the COVID vaccine and other dolls from STEM-related careers. Now, not to be outdone, anti-vaxxers and Trumpers are putting out their own dolls. It quits school in the 9th grade and marries a sexual predator. It's called the Flat Earth Lauren Boebert. Thank you, Steve. That was Steve Goody clapping, everybody. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we've got a fabulous show that starts right now. And by the way, if you go to Doc Pierce's, you won't hear any of those jokes. Let me tell you that right now. So, ladies and gentlemen, he is the main host. Let's replace him. It's Steve Goody right there.
Hi, everybody. Hey, Tim for Brad. Brad and his boss. Oh, it's fantastic, Brad. Well, I've got this microphone right in my face, so you can hear me really clearly, so that's good. It's time for a top 10 list. We do this every week, kind of a throwback to Letterman. And, oh, tonight's extra special because a lot of these top 10 lists I've been doing lately have been kind of politically loaded and about current events. But tonight it's just going to be ridiculous. Because, as you may know, some of you know this about me. For over 20 years, I've been a big fan of Martha Stewart. And her recipes. I just enjoy her recipes so much. And I was just thinking about one that I over 20 years ago, I learned about this. It's something called kitchen sink cookies. Has anybody heard of this?
Uh-uh.
Here's a shot of her webpage. It's basically a cookie recipe where you throw everything in. That's why she calls it kitchen sink cookies, which is awesome. And I was thinking the good top 10 list might be the top 10 ingredients in kitchen sink cookies. So that's what we're going to do. It's going to be a little silly. I hope you enjoy it. And some of it will be a little bit gross. See if you can figure out which ones are the really gross ones. All right. Top 10 ingredients in a Martha Stewart kitchen sink cookie recipe. Number 10, a potato chip shaped like Ernest Borgnine.
Mm.
Number 9, 2 Flintstones chewable Wilmas.
Oh.
Number 8, distributor cap from the Oscar Mayer Wienermobile.
Mm. What a liar.
Number 7, 3/5 of a cockroach.
Oh.
That's not the one. Number 6, the Norwegian handball team's discarded bikini bottoms.
Oh.
speaking of the Olympics. Number five, Lance Armstrong's roided up cancerous testicle.
Oh my God. Whoa.
That's the one. Let's carry on. Number four, a piece of chewing gum pried from the Statue of Liberty's left armpit. I know. Number three, two spoonfuls of strained bananas scraped off Ron DeSantis' wall after he found out he has to wear a mask. I don't know about this one. Number two, Britney Spears, IUD.
Oh.
I know, I feel the same way.
That was bad.
And the number one ingredient in a Martha Stewart kitchen sink cookie recipe, cilantro.
Oh, the worst one. The worst one.
Now,
we need a palate cleanser after that. What else you got?
Funny you would ask, Brad, because it has occurred to me in a couple of these top 10 lists, people have asked me, do you just write 10 things and that's it? No, of course not. I write way more than 10 things, and I call the really good ones, as you could hear in that last one. So tonight, as a special bonus, we're going to hear some of the outtakes in what's something I call the bottom 10 ingredients in a Martha Stewart.
Oh, no.
Here we go. A pinch of salt, a garbage disposal, three unmatching Subaru wheel covers, Letterman's beard, broken Ray-Ban knockoffs, two rectangles of middle school pizza, discarded overalls from a Canadian hippie, 45 tax returns, a truck stop urinal cake, and Nemo, we found him!
Steve Goody, everybody, there he is right there. There he is.
That's all I got to say about that.
That took a lot of time to be that icky.
You need to write it or to listen to it?
To listen to it was tough too, but to write it took a lot of time. So, okay, Steve, I brought you up. What? Oh, Dustin was going to talk. So, Steve, I put you up here with me too, so you can bring Perry in because you can figure out how we're going to do this with him. So, bring him in.
Under control, not to worry. Here comes our friend Perry Barton, everybody.
Yay!
Perry is a brilliant musician, which means that by union rules, Brad has to go away. So,
yeah, hello. Okay, good.
Perry, I've worked with many times doing funny, funny songs that we make up on the spot, and Perry's one of the best I've ever seen at this. Before we started the show, I had some folks offer suggestions to Perry. Perry, do you have anything to say before we begin?
Just thank you for having me back, and I look forward to seeing the wild and wacky suggestions people have that I might make into instant songs.
Yes. Well, the first thing he asked for is for people to suggest a perishable food item from the grocery store. And we're going to go with guacamole.
Ooh.
Okay. I'm going to leave now, and it's all you.
So we're just going to be one choice then?
Oh, you want another one too? Okay, eggs.
Okay. Yeah.
Stinky cheese.
Okay. Oh, I see good, you want to pick from them. I didn't understand. All right.
Yeah, sometimes, you know, I might even do like this. Stinky eggs are fine if you've got the time to peel them, but I don't know about that. Sometimes that's not just what I'm feeling. Give me guacamole, maybe sprinkle in some live roly-polies. I'm not picky, I'm just gross. I would like to eat a whole bowl full of those. Guacamole and stinky cheese, nothing more would quite please me like this. Don't forget to put the roly-polies in last so they'll still be live.
He'll be back, folks. That's our genius friend, Perry Barton.
And he'll be back. Let's hear it for him, everybody. That was fantastic. Hi, how y'all doing? Everybody good? That was fantastic. You know what? Hey, Steve, while you're there, bring Phil Van Tee up with me. Since I could do it, but since you're standing there doing nothing. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Phil Van Tee. Phil, I didn't get to talk last time because I wasn't here for your last set. Do you remember me at all from 30 years ago?
Looking at you now, just so that, because, you know, that sweet little smile of yours is in jeopardy, I'll say, sure, Brad.
No, so you do not. No, you would remember me from a very specific place, from literally 32, 3, literally 1987.
Bill, don't feel bad.
The comedy condo where we all lost a weekend together with Ray Milland?
No, I thought you were going to say virginity, but no. So we lost.
Bill,
no.
Bill, if I may, Bill, don't panic. He asks me the same thing every week.
That's not true. That's not true. So, Phil, so back in this, from March to November of 87, I was the light and sound guy at Crackers Comedy Club in Indianapolis.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, did you see the post that was put up in memoriam to?
Yes, Jim Schliebner passed away. And I loved Jim, even though he was also a little crooked, but that's not the point. But I loved him. But that's not what I want to talk about, is you came in, and I can't remember who you worked with, but it was one of my favorite weeks of the whole time. And you did it. You had a song where you played Werewolves of London, but it would stop in London and say Cleveland. Do you remember doing that at all?
Remember doing the werewolf hand scene from American Werewolf in London, as the hand got bigger, the limbs got bigger. But doing the song, nah, I don't remember it at all.
Oh, yeah, you played, you actually.
Did I accompany myself on a one-string banjo by chance?
No. You had me play audio of the actual song, and I think it was your To Walk Up to Stage song, and it was Werewolves of London, but then it would stop right where it said London and say, Cleveland. And then you would
want to. You know what? I actually remember this. And then Phil would take the stage and stand in a big tub of water, and we'd drop in a toaster.
Wow. Let's go back to the Lost Weekend reference. I think
I just remember that we enjoyed you wholeheartedly. And you were wearing, a lot of times you would wear a dark red cardigan with a black tie and a white shirt. As it was very fun, very fun, and we loved having you.
It's so cool that you would reminisce about that stuff. By the way, does this count as part of my time?
It does not in any way. Not no. Take all the time you need.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Nope. This isn't it. Ladies and gentlemen, Steve's going to take me out. Phil Van Tee doing his entire 10 minutes or so.
Thanks, folks. Nice to be back. Let's start with a rope trick, because I learned everything that I needed to know from an old guy named El Ropo. And what does this do? I don't know, but all the magicians have them. Notice I've decorated this wizard hoop with brightly colored electrical tape. I decorate everything now with brightly colored, say it with me, with brightly colored
electrical tape.
Thank you, everybody, for participating. I love brightly colored electrical tape. If I ever kidnap anyone, they're going to look fabulous. All right. Oh, it was just good for that joke. Okay. Here's one called Threading the Needle. It's an all-time favorite all around the world. That's the eye of the needle. This is the thread. Goes through there. You get the idea. Don't blink. This happens really fast. What are the odds? You all blinked at this big time. Try to control yourselves. They say you should never do the same trick twice in front of an audience. Don't care. He's a rebel. Okay, enough rope tricks. Now we're going to do a string trick. Very similar. Does anyone here have a string? Anyone? No? That's okay. We'll use this rope. Remembered what this is. What? This is called the little bridge. See that little bridge right there? A lot of these ring and rope tricks have names, like yo-yo tricks. Remember yo-yo tricks like walk the dog, rock the cradle, put the dog to sleep in the cradle. That's not one of them. Never. That's a little opposite. Anyway, notice the bridge, the rope, is on the outside of the ring. I'm going to pinch it right there so it stays on the outside of the ring. Watch that part. Don't take your eyes off of the... you blinked again. Okay. Threading the needle was just a precursor to the invisible thimble routine. Can any of you in TV land, Zoom land, see the invisible thimble? No, because it's invisible. Maybe on this side over here. Wait for it. Ha! I think you see it.
No! Wow.
The cutest little thimble. Nobody knows what a thimble is anymore. I'm here to re-educate this world. All right, this is called the thimble goes up in the air and I catch it on my finger trick. What do you think?
Wow.
Yeah.
That's enough. We don't have time for reactions. Slow motion. Here we go. I'm the only guy that does it in slow motion. You're so lucky I'm here. Here, watch. It's really slow. Up in the air and I catch it on my finger trick. I make my own wizard thimbles. I have a catalytic thimble generator, which looks a lot like a 20th century clothespin. But if you plug it in like a little flash drive there, that turns this into a 3D scanner. The printer is right down here. I'll just do it. The original, place it inside the scanner. Once it's had its way with it there, gets all the information it needs. Ka-chunk, ka-chunk, ka-chunk. You print an exact duplicate. Again, for those of you who care. That's it. This gets kind of redundant after a while. But that's what a printer is, isn't it? It's in the redundancy business. Deal with it. All right? Ka-chunk, ka-chunk, ka-chunk. We're running out of fingers here. Just thumb. That's good enough. Ka-chunk, ka-chunk. Toner. We ran out of toner. Toner. That's all right. Toner is everywhere, even in not there. That's there. It is. Oh, watch this. Watch this.
Oh, toner.
Woo! Thanks. That's enough. All right. Speaking of clever uses of clothespins, this is my old street show tip jar can thingy. There. Yes, I used to do street shows. My grandma gave me this on her deathbed. She didn't die. She's just very dramatic. Come here, my son. Just, I have something for you. Oh, great. Another hanky. Yeah. Actually, Grandpa gave me this one. He was very comfortable with his manhood there. All right. So I always kept a Mardi Gras doubloon clipped to the top of my tip can as a subliminal suggestion that we should support the performing arts. That goes right there. Clever, eh?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I have to say it. Nobody else ever does. And these grandma hankies are very dear to me, mainly because each one comes with another Mardi Gras doubloon, which just happens to match the hanky. Yeah, calm down, everybody. What are the odds that if we change color, don't get ahead of me, all right? Foreshadowing. Just, would it maybe? It did!
Wow.
It did this!
Oh.
And another one, just like the other
one.
Yes, that's a big surprise. All right. Okay, even I'm bored with that one. All right, so we did that. Wait a minute. I'm going back to the Magic Castle. They're open again. I got to practice tying my tie again. Don't remember. I say right over left and left over right. Is this right?
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, that's good. Perfect.
What? Tighter? Cruel so-and-so. What's it?
Wow.
Salad through salad. Yeah. My wife says if I really wanted to do salad through salad, it ought to be up about 9 inches right here. But that's my wife's sense of humor or something about my hard head there. All right. Did we? Yes, we did. Okay. Now I'm going to teach you a trick, but you probably don't have a wizard rope like Phil Van T. So your trick is going to be a shoelace trick. Everybody has a shoelace. So look at the size of this thing. My feet must be huge. Okay. This is called the knot disappears from here. Wait, we got to actually have a knot. There we go. All right. We're in. All right. The knot disappears from here and appears over here. By the way, this whole premise of teaching the audience a magic trick, it's a bunch of malarkey. Yeah. So anytime a magician says, we're going to teach you a magic trick, kids, you can be pretty sure he's just going to make fun of the whole concept. But that being said, I will now teach you a magic trick. The knot disappears from here, ends up, just do it! Okay, watch. I'm going to actually do it behind my back because I don't want to give it away just yet. So it starts over here. You can clearly see it. And it ends up over here. Wow. All right, thanks. Okay, yeah, okay. That's probably be a better trick if I could actually. There's a way to do it. It's called the pluck it like a flower method. Yeah. Let's start over again, shall we? Yeah. Brad, tell your story about crackers. No, that's all right.
So back in the day.
Here we go. This is, remember when we had one knot? Yes, it's fun to reminisce. And then I went behind my back, because I'm a professional, and we had two knots. But we figured out how that was done, didn't we? Yes, we did. We had an extra knot, didn't we? This is one of my favorite parts, because it looks, to me anyway, maybe it looks like a little bird puppet, doesn't it? Let's go over there, little bird. Dink a dink a dink a dink a dink. Hey, he looks kind of like me. Made him some little glasses there. See his little bird butt? Shake your tail feathers, birdie. There you go. Okay, if the bird gets scared, nature has provided him with a wonderful ability to, his neck gets longer, see, that he could look over a rock or around a tree or something like that. Sometimes his head disappears, which is very disconcerting for the bird. Sometimes his feet disappear, but who cares at this point? He doesn't even have a head. What good are the feet gonna do? And then, wait, he's hopping around on one foot, not anymore. Okay, I'd like to close with a snake puppet. Here's the snake's head, which looks suspiciously like the bird head we saw earlier. This is a yellow shoelace snake wrapped around a Caucasian arm. I'm the Caucasian, it's log, Caucasian log. All right, I'm the Caucasian log. Peeking out from a Caucasian log, that's, don't be scared, it's still a shoelace. Okay. I finally, the finale. I'd like to close with a cut and restored, wait a minute, first, you've probably never seen this unless you've been to the freak show, but they also have a two-headed snake. All right, I'm gonna lobotomize one of them because I'm about to do the cut and restored snake trick. I'm the only guy that does the cut and restore. I'll be using these safety scissors. It's more humane. But a dull knife hurts more. Shut up. All right. This is the cut and restore. Snip, snip, here, snip, snip, there, and a couple of latidas. That's the vasectomy, son. There we go. And restored. Well, cut anyway. That's good enough for rock and roll. They're not even. They're not even what? Shut up. I'll do it. I got this. Even Steven. Magic snake words.
Hey.
And for the particular audience members, restored once again.
Wow.
No, you can't look at the rope. All right.
What? Wait, was that? Wait, was that it? Wait.
Thank you for the opportunity, and yes, Brad, I do remember because you even told me, even back then, you told me how much Jim was paying you for the opportunity to be part of the comedy club milieu there, and it was more than I made in my first job. It was like $4 an hour or something.
It was exactly $4 an hour is what I made.
And I could have just read your post while I was...
You could have read my post. So, by the way, Phil, so then in 92, I have a story. No, I'm just kidding. So let's hear it for Phil Van T. Everybody, that was fantastic.
Wait a minute.
Amazing job. I can't believe how wonderful that was.
Finally take the ice pack out of my butt.
That's great. Hey, watch this. Here's the greatest trick. He disappears. So, wow, that was amazing. So that was really fun. I love that. I can't believe he doesn't remember me sending him on stage in 1987. That's crazy. So, you know who does remember me from 1987? Do y'all know who remembers me from 1987? Patty Vasquez remembers me from 1987. Hi, Patty. You're in a car again.
I am in a car again, and compared to last time, you can tell that we're getting later in the year because I had more daylight. Now I'm trying to find the best, like, street lighting from the lamps.
Like, that's not doing it. You're in a different car. What car are you in?
I am. I'm in my Prius.
You got all the money in the world, you buying all the cars.
Yeah, I have a 2010 Prius, and then I also have a RAV hybrid. They're both hybrids, and my mommy bought me that one. Yeah.
Good job.
Thank you.
All right, so Patty, it's so lovely to see you. I hope things are going well. Actually, I don't. Tell me what's not going well.
Okay, so here's the thing, and I apologize for being in my car or wearing a baseball hat and it's hard to see me, but first of all, what a wonderful night. I'm so happy to join you guys. I mean, the purity of Phil Van T's work and do you get how wonderful and delightful it is to hang out with you on Thursday nights and Perry and Brad and Steve every week and all of you lovelies being there? Because I now have a radio show, so I am opened up to, like, idiots out there, and I forgot what that was like. They're calling into my show, and I was talking today about how in Chicago we have choked off opportunities for Black and brown communities for decades. And I went to a school where I was the only Mexican, and I'm Mexican and Irish. And I remember the first time I knew I was different, I was at my friend Susie's house, and she's German. And we're still friends, by the way. But her dad came down, I remember him coming down the stairs, and he looked at me and he goes, "Where are you from?" I don't know why he had a Southern accent on the northwest side of Chicago, but that's how I hear it in my head. And he goes, "Where are you from?" And I was like, "I just live a couple blocks away." I was 7. I didn't know what he was saying. And he goes, "No, I mean, like, where are your people from? Like, we're in a tribe somehow. We're moving around or something." And he goes, no. So where are your folks from? And I said, "Well, my dad's from Chicago and my mom came here from Mexico." "Mexico, huh? Huh. What's your dad?" And I was like, "Well, he's Irish." And he goes, "Oh, you're Irish. I guess you're okay then."
Oh my God. Oh.
And then he said, "How'd your dad get a Mexican one?" And it was, I tried imagining, like, maybe my dad, like, how do you get a Mexican one? Like, do you go to the store to look for a white and the only thing that's left is a clearance table? And you're like, "I guess I'll take a Mexican one. I don't know." So the reason I was telling this story on the air was I was talking about how in my school, I was the only person of color that lived in the neighborhood, but they were desegregating the school, bringing Black kids into our neighborhood, yanking them out of their communities, making them ride an hour and a half to the northwest side of Chicago, where they basically said, "Your neighborhood's not worth investing, but we'll take you to a pretty part of the city where it's clean and it's safe. You can't stay here, but our schools are better, and then we'll send you back." And I was saying that we have basically taught the Black population in Chicago, "We're not going to invest in you, but we'll show you where it's prettier." And that's why a lot of Black people moved out of their communities. Then someone called me and said, "Well, Patty, you're not telling the whole story. See, what really happened was," and this is always my favorite part, she goes, they were supposed to send white kids to Black neighborhoods, but we didn't want to send our kids to places we didn't know, and where they were, they wouldn't tell us where it was, and we weren't going to let our kids go there. But we were very nice to the Black kids that came in our neighborhoods, and we made cakes for them. And I said, "But do you not think that maybe it was hard for those parents who had sent their kids to a community that was unfamiliar?" And she's like, "Oh, I never thought of it that way. Didn't you? Didn't you?" At any rate, yes. So the schools I talked about today, because Mayor Lightfoot I'm so tired of people saying buckets for their policy. Policies do not go in buckets. We have a health bucket for brown and Black communities. We have a healthcare, we have education buckets. Stop with the buckets and just make things better. I'm done melting. Thank you for your time.
Oh, just, so, well, now, wait a minute. I wanted to be her in there. What happened? Add spotlight. Okay, Patty, you're back. Okay, so I noticed, because I was on your show the other day, that I thought you had only, like, progressive people call. Do you get the other side?
Oh, so my call screener will put, like, conservative wants to yell at you.
Nice.
So I take those. Yeah.
You have to. You have to take those. You have to take them every time.
Fun? Yeah. Well, and she started it with, "You're not telling the whole story." I'm like, "You mean from when I was five? I'm not telling the whole story about when I was..."
You are holding back the real information. You are holding it back.
Yes.
Yeah, how dare you?
They wanted to yank our white children and send them to black communities. Okay.
Yeah. Well, in some places they did do that. They made them go back and forth. Yep. And and that's why I never understand. Well, that's why I get so mad at people with their, "Well, we should let people have school choice. And then do you give the money that they would have gotten for that school toward the money for a private school?" Oh, that's nice. The private school is $25,000 a year. And what you want is $6,000 off that price, and still knowing that nobody you don't want there can afford the freaking school, you racist piece of garbage. Yeah, it drives me nuts.
Ding, 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 ding.
I know. So where were you tonight?
I was at a neighborhood meeting, an association, like a Gladstone Park Neighbors Association. And Congressman Quigley was there, and I felt rude leaving while he was talking about the terrorists attacking the Capitol. And I thought it was important to listen to him because it was fascinating. He was talking about how hard it is to get anything done or even want to work with the crazies. And it was fascinating because he still looks shook up. So,
wow.
Yeah.
I'm not surprised. I would be shook up too.
Yep.
Yeah. We got to figure this out, how to get rid of, just to move forward in some way. Luckily it won't happen here. I think that's not going to happen here. So Patty Vasquez melting away. I don't know who I'm pointing at, but let's hear it for Patty Vasquez. So by the way, Patty reminds me to tell everybody that, this is a good time to go to virtualcomedyshow.com. Steve, I don't think you put that in the thing.
I did. We're not there yet.
Oh, well, no. I'm saying that when you went live, all you put was nothing.
I put nothing. That's right.
Yeah. Well, the point is, people have to go to virtualcomedyshow.com, click donate to the comedians, and we will split the money between everybody, and we will give some to Phil for some memory capsules. Maybe he'll come back and remember me. But so please do that. Also, I have a new comedy single out.
Hold on, Brad. You're out of order, sir. Before we do all of that, we have our second improvised song.
No, I want to do this before that, and then we'll do that, and then we'll go right to the video. So I wanted to change it up a little bit and do this now because I want to be ready. So I just want to say that I want everybody to go. I have a new comedy single out everywhere. Okay, Steve, we can do that then. Bring Perry back. We've got another great song with Perry, another improv song. Okay. And bring yourself in. And,
I'm trying, but you keep changing everything on me. Hang on.
I'm not touching a thing.
I'm so confused.
Don't be confused.
This is the part of the show where Brad thinks whatever he wants is just fine, and I will snap too. And I can't find Perry because I wasn't ready for this.
Oh my God!
Hi, Perry.
I'm over here.
Hi, Perry.
Hey, Perry.
We want to hear another fabulous made-up song from you. And one thing you asked for us was titles of songs that don't exist but that should. And how many would you like to hear before you pick one?
Yeah, two or three if you got them.
All right. Here's a couple that I like. You racist piece of garbage.
Okay.
I just decided that was one.
Okay.
Freezing in the Yukon.
That's a good one.
And everybody needs a cat.
Ah, okay. All right. Are you with me?
Yeah.
With you.
Some people like dogs, some people like bullfrogs, some people want an anaconda, they name it something embarrassing like Wanda, but wait. There's another kind of pet that I appreciate. You may be asking yourself, oh, tell me what's that? I wanna say I like cats, 'cause everybody deserves a cat. Everybody needs a cat. cat. You want somebody who is not so attached. You want somebody who will not mind if you are playing match game. A really old TV show no one remembers unless they are our age. But anyway, I digress, I digress. Cats are the best, cats are the best. But you gotta learn to clean out the litter box. Don't wanna step in something nasty in your socks. Other than that, it's a great thing. You can leave for a long weekend and they won't suspect anything. I love the cats. I'm not talking about the Broadway musical. I love the cats. What is this song I just did? I do not know. I feel totally quizzical. Ow!
Yeah.
Yeah.
Perry Barton and the Perry Barton Orchestra.
Wow. Cats. That was funky, funky.
And I was a cat owner for many, many, many years, and she's no longer with us, but so it's true.
Aw, that's sweet.
And now it's got a sad twist at the end.
Yeah, well, it's a sad twist at the
end. She died 20 years ago. I'm kind of past it, but you know.
Kind of 20 years ago. Cat, the cat's been dead longer than it was alive. So that's really great.
It was a long, long time ago. But
a long, long time ago. So, all right. Perry Barton, everybody. Yay. Thank you very much.
All the guns on that. Well, that's fantastic.
Yeah. So, okay. So, Steve, why switch the thing up on you is because I want to talk about something that we're going to play right now. And that is a couple weeks ago or last month, I was asked to participate in a video, an alt country video. So this is not a comedy video, but somebody thought I looked goofy and weird, and they asked me to play a priest. My friend Jonah Rose, who's a alt country artist, who's really doing well. And he had a song called Set Me Free, where he is set free. And I play the priest in the river. And I said I would promote this song because I really think it's a good song. And I had fun doing the video. So here it is, Set Me Free, everybody, by Jonah Rose. So.
Sing the blues you sing. the crossroads at night when the young man sleeps. Oh. I was born on a dusty back road, raised on Skinner Eggs on Willie and Jones.
Mm. Hilarious.
We have to keep going till we see Brad's name.
That's right. There's my name. I was a priest. So that was hilarious, wasn't it? By the way, I made it hard on him because every time I was screaming at him, I was screaming like, "You smell of elderberry. Your urine tastes like garbage. You peat moss bus." I was just all the stuff. And so we had to do like 70 takes because he kept cracking up. And man, I would dunk him under the water and hold him under there. He would be like,
Phil Van Tee just texted me. He says he remembers now. That's how you met him too.
That's how I met him too. I did that. So, yep. Oh, folks. Well, this has been a fantastic show. Let's thank everybody. First of all, Perry Barton, very clever, very amazing. Let's hear it for Perry Barton. Just making up stuff and being a great musician. Also, Phil Van Tee, always incredible. Can't wait to see him back at the Comedy Magic Club, right? That's where you're going back to. And, of course, Patty Vasquez is the joy of all of our lives forever. And always good. And Steve Goody really icking us out this week. I thought that was great. A little icky stuff. And I think that was fantastic. Okay. Well, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for coming. This is the worst joke of the week. And it truly is this week the worst joke of the week. Then we'll play the Thursday song. And then we'll say goodbye to Facebook. Steve, remember to do that. Here we go. The worst joke of the week. Democratic lawmakers in New York have said they will begin impeachment proceedings against Governor Cuomo. And Republican lawmakers have said, see, if you were one of us, you could molest even kids and we'd support you. Goodbye, everybody.
Yeah. Have a very merry Thursday. It's a special time of week when Thursday bells are pealing and life no longer seems so bleak. Let's open up our presents and carve our Thursday goose and wait for Father Thursday to arrive upon his moose.
You know, we tried to incorporate all the wonderful family traditions that people associate with Thursday.
Thursday comes but once a week, but do not shed a tear. Cause there are more than 50 Thursdays packed in every year. And every single one of them is full of mirth and glee. So stuff your face and break some wind and join the reverie. Have a very merry Thursday. Put on your orange fez and decorate the Thursday tree with milkbone, spam, and pez. Once you've curled your mustache and donned your Thursday clothes, I'll catch you neath the mistletoe and punch you in the nose. Merry Thursday! Merry Thursday! Merry Thursday!
Say goodbye to Facebook.